Session two in our colloquium is going to be about the less discussed issue of UK's negotiation with the rest of the world, specifically the UK's negotiations with respect to FTAs. European Union is one of the most significant FTA partners, and by leaving the European Union, it also potentially means that they have left all of those FTAs as well. So what will the future look like for the United Kingdom with respect to existing EU FTAs, as well as possible future FTAs that the United Kingdom will try to negotiate? Will it negotiate new trade deals with the US and other key countries? How will other countries within the European Union's FTAs respond to one of the most important EU members leaving its FTA? So there's a whole range of issues that come up in the context of session two. So welcome back to the University of Notre Dame in London for our discussion with our panel of experts. This panel is going to be led by Jennifer Hillman from Georgetown University, Simon Lester from Cato, Rob Howse remotely from NYU, and myself, Roger Alford. Jennifer.
All right, well, I thought I would just start out by commenting on the existing arrangements currently between the EU with the UK as part of it and sort of the rest of the world. And again, you can't see it, but I have a map here that will show you that the EU is already in lots of agreements. A fair number of them would be called free trade agreements, meaning they cover virtually all trade and result in zero duties on anything. That would be particularly their agreements with most recently Canada, as well as South Korea and a number of others. Obviously, with some of the other closer states like Iceland, Norway, Switzerland, where they have very particular agreements between the European Union and those other countries, the Faroe Islands. They have a particular agreement with Mexico, with a number of the Central American countries. Then the EU has a customs union with Andorra, with San Marino, and with Turkey. More importantly, I would say, with Turkey. It then has a huge plethora of agreements that fall into this category of stabilization or association agreements, you know, heavily throughout the Middle East and much of the parts of Africa. And then they have a number of economic partnership agreements. These are largely with what used to be some of their former colonial states, but again, falling under, you know, the CARA Forum, as well as many in Africa with SADC, with West Africa, etc. So there's this huge array of agreements that fall on the spectrum, all the way between really true free trade agreements that provide the free movement of goods and services and have very deep commitments, over to somewhat unilateral preference agreements that are really intended to be for the economic benefit of whoever they're with. So the question comes, what happens upon Brexit to the UK's relationship to each one of these agreements and each one of these trading partners? And there, I think, you know, interestingly to me, it's become a bit of a debated question about what happens. I mean, what exactly do these agreements provide? So I started looking at exactly how do the agreements define who is the party to the agreement. Because I think at some level, as a good lawyer, you want to think about, well, does the UK have any rights on its own in any of these agreements, or are all of its rights derivative of the fact that it's a member of the EU? So I will read out for you, all you budding lawyers in the room, the most common way in which this is phrased. So this comes out of the Korea agreement, but I would say it's this same language appears in many of these agreements. So what it says, and again, I call this the or-and formulation, so as you hear it, you know, sort of interestingly, that parties mean, on the one hand, the European Union or its member states, and then it typically puts in a list of those member states, and it expressly includes, obviously, in that list, the United Kingdom of Great Britain and Northern Ireland. So they are expressly listed. So it means the European Union or its member states, or the European Union and its member states within their respective areas of competence as derived by the Treaty on the European Union and the Treaty on the Functioning of the European Union, hereinafter referred to as the EU. Okay, so you all lawyers out there, what does that tell you? If the parties are the European Union or its member states, specifically listing them. So in other words, you could read the treaty to say this is a treaty between the European Union or the United Kingdom, or the European Union and its member states within their respective area of competence. Is the UK on its own a member? And I will tell you that, you know, there's some debate about it. I personally think that, well, I'll leave aside where I personally think. But again, so the argument that's typically made is that the rights to perform the obligations under these free trade agreements and other agreements do not extend to the UK once it terminates its status as a member of this agreement. In other words, the UK would not be obligated to do any of these things once it's no longer in. Another argument would be made that the UK, as a contracting party to the Treaty of Europe, you know, there is a basis for inclusion, but these are essentially bilateral agreements between the European Union and SODIC, between the European Union and Canada, et cetera. And to the extent that there's any, you know, any court law out there, there was a case on the European Development Fund which said that at least the Lomé Convention, the court said, does establish essentially a bilateral agreement between the ACP countries and the European Union. So it is clearly saying, at least with the same kind of language, with this or and language that I described, the court at least is saying that's a bilateral deal between the European Union and, in that instance, the ACP. Then you look at the intent of the parties. What was the intent of the parties? To me, my general sense is the intent of the parties in these agreements is to do a deal with the EU as a whole. Because clearly what the trading partners are wanting is a lot of what we've already talked about. They're wanting duty-free access to the entirety of the EU, but they're also wanting all of these passporting rights. They're wanting to be able to invest in the UK and go from the UK into the rest of the European Union without any barriers, without any tariffs, without any second clearance, without any second inspection, etc. So to me, the intent of the party says they intended to get access to the entirety of the EU market, and anything less than that is not what they intended, and therefore the intent of the parties is that this is an agreement only between the EU and whoever it's with, and it's not with the individual member states. You could make an argument that the only reason the UK signed the agreement separately, so again, each one of these agreements would have been signed by the UK. What do you make of that, that the UK individually signed the treaty? And the UK Parliament individually approved the CETA and individually approved the Korea Agreement and individually approved. So the UK Parliament has voted on all of these and the UK as a government has signed all of these. Does that mean that the treaty is binding on the UK alone? Again, the question will come whether the UK is signing only because of the division of competence within the EU system. In other words, when the agreement goes outside of purely sole competence for the European Union, anything outside of trade or investment law, anything touching on labor, environment, all these other issues automatically brings in this other competence. You say, okay, that's the only reason why the UK was signing it. It wasn't signing this treaty to get its own individual relationship with this trading partner, that the UK is not actually a party to an FTA until all of the member states have approved it, because the party doesn't come into. So in other words, the UK cannot on its own end up with an arrangement with Canada because it takes all of the member states approving it, and the agreement doesn't come into effect until that's the case. And again, that the third party doesn't enter into it into an agreement other than with all of the EU. So for me, there's a lot of reasons. If you then look, for example, into what territory does the agreement apply to? These treaties are all very specific about what does it apply to, and it makes it very clear that the territories which are the subject of the Treaty on the European Union and the Treaty on the Functioning of the EU is the territory that is covered by this free trade agreement. So the customs territory, as it's defined in these agreements, includes the entirety of the EU. So for me, it makes a pretty good case that the UK is not on its own, cannot on its own necessarily be considered it. And I will tell you, there's other people that say, no. You know, this, it makes perfect sense to say that as a signatory of the free trade agreement, the UK on its own has rights under this treaty on its own. It will continue to be bound by these obligations.
Oh, hi, Matt. I've lost the sound completely. I can't hear what's going on in the room. It's raw.
Okay. Sorry. Keep going, Jennifer. I'll work.
Anyway, so others would say, look at, for example, for all of you in public international lawyers out there, look at the Vienna Convention on the principle of continuity. Look at the Vienna Convention on changed circumstances, that there's a number of ways in which you could or should interpret these treaties to say that the UK remains a party to them when it has signed on its own, when it has approved through its parliament on its own membership in these agreements. So for me, just this whole issue of what is, on day one of Brexit, what is the UK's relationship with all of these parties, all of these trade agreement parties, I think is one of those questions that needs a lot of more legal analysis that, I personally think it's more weighs on the favor of they are not a party and they don't have a privileged trade relationship with any of these free trade party partners that exist right now. But others might disagree a little bit. The second question then comes, if you think I'm right, that the legal relationship between the UK and all of these 41 different trading partners under these various different trade agreements ceases to exist, again, what then happens? What should or could the UK do in order to restore these relationships or to create new ones? And there again, I think you run into huge issues in terms of both timing, sequencing, and what should be the desire of the UK. A timing issue you run into from the very get-go, which is in theory, they cannot negotiate, until they have formally left the EU, because all negotiating competence resides with the EU. So until the UK has formally, completely withdrawn and the treaties of Europe cease to apply to it, it is not lawfully permitted to engage in any trade negotiations with anyone for any purpose. So then how much can get done in advance remains a bit of an open question. What the UK has said is, okay, we accept. And I think they're very much on record as saying, we accept that we cannot negotiate until we have formally terminated our relationship with the EU. But what we can engage in is what they call scoping. So we will begin, if not have already begun to some degree, this idea of scoping, meaning what would be the parameters of an agreement that we could work out. What would generally be in it? Would it cover just goods? Would it cover goods and services? Would it cover intellectual property? Would it cover regulatory barriers? Would it cover how big or broad or deep would this agreement be? At least their perception is we can do that in advance. The third thing on timing is whether how long would any of these agreements take to actually negotiate and or to come into compliance? So if you look, for example, at the Canada agreement, most recently negotiated, negotiations began in May of 2009, finished in August of 2014, and the agreement was ratified on October 30th of 2016. Okay, so that means you're in a 7 or 8 year time frame. I think the EU-Korea agreement was even longer, was about 8 years. So if on day one of Brexit, the UK has no particular trade relationship with any of these 40-some trading partners, and it's going to take it between 7 and 8 years to regain one, you can see that this is really, really problematic. And then it's going to get into the issue of where should the priorities be, and I think Simon is going to address that a bit, in terms of if you're in the UK's shoes, where do you start? Do you want to start with where the EU used to have a free trade agreement on the theory that it would be much faster and easier to just basically copy the EU-Canada agreement and now make it a UK-Canada agreement and just copy the Korea agreement and just copy the South Africa agreement and just copy the Mexico agreement? You might take the view that that's the easiest, fastest thing for the UK to do, and therefore that should be their priority. You might, on the other hand, actually look at the trade numbers and say, well, actually, if you just look from a trade perspective of where are our markets outside of the European Union, let's assume we've got a deal with the European Union, That's the United States and China. So why would you bother to go back and renegotiate this Canada agreement or this Korea agreement or this whatever agreement just because the EU did it? Why shouldn't we start from scratch and start with the United States and China? That's where our big trade interests lie. And then I'm sure, as Simon is going to tell you, it also depends on where are there actually big tariffs or non-tariff barriers that are standing in the way of your exports, because maybe that's where you really want to go after, where there's actual barriers that are affecting your trade that can be removed as the result of a trade agreement. And I would presume that on top of all of that, you want to put into the mix, where is it realistic that we could get an agreement? So while you might say China is a big market, nobody is having very much good luck getting good agreements with China. So is that a waste of time, or because they're a big trading partner, do you want to start there? So I think the UK has got a whole lot of issues to think through. And my own sense is, starting with, do you want to try to make the claim that because you have signed each one of these agreements and your parliament has ratified them, that you somehow have some form of residual rights in these agreements or not? So it's sort of an interesting question for any of you out there looking to write, you know, an article or think this through. But I think it's one of the many, many, many interesting legal issues that gets raised by Brexit.
Go ahead.
Okay, I have two comments on that. So first, your discussion of UK participation in existing EU FTAs, that's fascinating. I hadn't thought about it much before. I have three questions about it, none of which you have to answer, but just things that occurred to me. First is that, could the UK bring a test case, like bring a complaint under, for example, the EU-Korea FTA, and ask a panel to decide whether the UK is a member of that FTA, is a party to that FTA? It would be fun if they did. I don't know what, I mean.
Or even easier, could they just trade as if they are part of the FTA and both Korea and the UK go along with it?
Well, that leads to the second question. Well, sort of leads to the second question. Can the UK and Korea just agree that this agreement applies to them? Yeah, so, right, as long as both of those agree. And contrast that, though, could the EU and Korea, if Korea felt differently, could they amend their treaty to clarify that the UK is not a party?
Well, again, let me start with the third one first, because I think this issue actually raises a general issue that is true not just on these free trade agreements, but I would argue is true in the WTO as well, which is, does everybody have third-party rights against the EU? On the theory that, hey, wait a minute, I negotiated an agreement with you. Right. I agreed to lower my tariff to 10% for you when I thought you were a market of 500 million people, yeah. And when I thought I was getting access to the UK, and when I thought I was going to get passporting rights out of the UK into the rest of the European Union. Now that I'm not getting that, I'm going to up my tariff to you, because I wouldn't have made that deal if I had known you were going to let the UK pull out. So, you know, query, do all third parties have rights both under the WTO and under every one of these FTAs, and there's lots of them, to go back and say to the EU, I want a better deal, or I'm going to raise my tariffs to you or something because I didn't get what I bargained for.
Can't the EU just respond and say, but look, Article 50 is right there. You knew Article 50 was there. You knew somebody could pull out. Should have been aware of it. You know, you should have. It was reasonable for you to expect that somebody could have pulled out.
Except that no one had ever done it.
No one had ever done it, but it was there on paper.
And the people that drafted it said it was not designed to ever be invoked. But in any event, So on the third one, I think it raises huge issues about whether third parties do have any rights as a result. And obviously, when new members joined the EU, there were all these fights over the changes in the tariffs. When all the Eastern European countries came in, the EU had to file revised tariff schedules, and there were huge disputes over whether or not they had effectively cut people's trade or increase their trade, et cetera. So I think on the first one, a very interesting issue. Go back to your first and second ones. I just want to make sure.
Can the UK request, bring a complaint against Korea, just come up with some complaint to bring under the
And
EU
bring it FTA, where?
To a panel Whatever under the EU.
So all right. So again, let's just think about this. So there are dispute settlement mechanisms in most of these provisions that provide for a panel system to hear disputes under the, under the Korea EU FTA agreement, there is a separate dispute settlement mechanism that allows for panels to be set up to hear disputes under that agreement. if you're not a party to the agreement, presumably you don't have party, you don't have rights to its dispute settlement system.
But who would decide whether they're a party? I mean, can they request it and then would they then establish
it? That's a jurisdictional issue that most international arbitration tribunals would decide as a jurisdictional matter.
Right. So it would be right from the get-go, there would be a jurisdictional issue about whether or not the UK has the right to request a panel under a free trade agreement that it is a party to under this or and language that I've read out, because I think it is really interesting to think about it. Most people would interpret the or and language as existing solely because of this issue that the agreement is a mixed competence agreement, so that they had to add in that and part because they were going to need the UK to actually formally approve that portion of the agreement that fell under the mixed competence. In other words, people think intellectually, if you sort of think about it, that the reason why you have this, you know, that it's an agreement between Canada or whoever, Korea on the one hand, and the European Union or its member states, or the EU and its member states, within their respective areas of competence, is to sort of think about the pure trade parts of it and the pure investment parts of it is an agreement with the European Union, because the Union has sole competence. But when you now come over into labor, environment, et cetera, it's an agreement between the European Union and its member states, because the UK remains competent over labor, environment, et cetera. So in that sense, the treaty itself is split, and my thing would be, I think the dispute settlement provisions would fall into the former camp, where there's something that is entered into as an agreement by the union itself. So not clear that the UK would have separate rights under it. But I think a panel would have to decide right from the get-go. Do they even have jurisdiction to hear a dispute like that?
So can I just add two comments to that? So one thing I think that's important is, I think your argument is stronger if it is a mixed competence treaty, where the UK actually affirmatively had to sign onto the treaty to make the treaty effective. Whereas if it's a matter of exclusive competency, then I think
you're wrong again. The sound of the game going.
Okay, sorry. How about that? So I think you have more. You have more. A better argument if you say that for all of the mixed competency treaties, you're in the or and world where the UK is also a part of the treaty. So I think that may be one way to think about it. The other thing I would challenge you about, though, is that I think your argument proves too much. Because if what you're saying is true, that the UK can trade with Korea on a free trade basis because of this EU-Korea FTA, then isn't it also true that the UK can trade with the rest of the European Union as part of the UK-EU-Korea FTA as well? And therefore, you don't even need Brexit discussions at all. You've got it under the Korea-EU-UK FTA. So you got your free trade by virtue of the fact that the UK is a member of all of these other free trade agreements.
The UK could trade with the EU?
EU could trade with the EU. It's by this argument, the EU and the UK are both members to this treaty, and the UK trades with the EU under the EU.
Aren't they sort of a joint member?
I don't know. Yeah. I'm asking the question.
I do accept your point, and I think it's right that the agreements read differently when they're mixed competence agreements versus when they're sole competence EU agreements. Just in terms of the language defining who's a party to the agreement, you know, I do think it matters which they are. And I will say, in all of the mixed competence agreements, there's some formulation of these. Although the Canada one, to me, was very interesting. It's the most recent one, where all it says is that it's a comprehensive economic trade agreement between Canada on the one part and the European Union and its member states, and lists them on the other. So it does not have this or and language that all of the other mixed agreements have. And many of the sole agreements have much more, this is an agreement between the European Union and fill in the blank, whoever it may be. But I don't see how you get to the point where just because you're in a free trade agreement with Korea, that provides rights as between the UK and Europe.
I mean, anything's possible. I wouldn't have thought of that, but I mean, right, I was imagining two parties, the EU and the member states and Korea. But now if you take out, you know, separate out from the EU and its member states, now that you have the UK, can they say, well, we're a party to this and we can trade with both? I mean, certainly it's worth, they can try it.
Well, who can challenge the decision by the UK and the Korea to continue to give each other free trade status?
Right. I think if the UK and Korea agree on their own, then they can just do it.
I mean, under this existing treaty, we're going to treat each other as if we're free trade partners.
Yeah, I don't think anyone could do anything about it. If they want to agree, then they can agree. They can
and
say, we just take this language and adopt it.
And to me, the problem for Korea is if they're investing in or going into the UK in order to gain access into the EU. And there now is tariffs as between the UK and the EU, or barriers or of other kinds between the UK and the EU, then Korea doesn't really get what they really wanted, which is to be able to ship into the UK in order for it to go onward, duty-free, barrier-free, from the UK into the EU. And an awful lot of the cross-investment, I mean, think about now this, you know, is Nissan going to build cars in Sunderland? You know, it's really all about, can they have free access without the 10% duty on cars going into the European market?
So where do they go to challenge it? Do they go to the WTO and talk about nullification or impairment of benefits? It
depends on the terms of the dispute
settlement
mechanism of the treaty.
Of that treaty, yeah.
Rob, do you have anything to add to this or any other thoughts to this fascinating question about whether or not the UK is still a member of all these FTAs if it exits?
But I think I would love to hear Rob's take on
Rob, do you have any response to Jennifer's presentation?
Sure. So this seems a logical point to, intervene. I think we have to ask ourselves when does, and if it does, the decision for Brexit happen? Because until there is such a decision, this discussion of negotiations, despite the notion of scoping, can't really happen. And as we heard from the High Court last week in London, any decision to leave the EU would be an abrogation of the legal framework that Parliament passed, the European Communities Act, which provides that the UK shall be a member of the EU and is the basis for many complex legal adjustments in internal UK law that flow from that status. And so I begin from the proposition of the court, which of course could be overruled by the Supreme Court. We don't know yet, but I think it's highly unlikely that the trigger, even for the decision to pursue Brexit as understood in Article 50, would have to be legislative action because only an act of the legislature, of Parliament, can abrogate or alter the operation of another act of Parliament, especially when the original act, as the court suggested, creates acquired rights for individuals in a range of circumstances. So, assuming the decision is upheld, then there will have to be a complex legislative agenda to unwind the European Communities Act. In fact, before the process towards Brexit at the EU level can really begin. And so this, I think many commentators have suggested, would involve, a significant additional, period of delay. So then the question becomes, what happens if indeed there is such a trigger? Then, as I understand it, there are negotiations or attempted negotiations under, Article 50 on the terms of exit, which would eventually have to be put to the European Parliament. Again, I'm not an expert in EU law, but this is all building up to how this feeds into the external trade issues. But also, I think if you follow the logic of the High Court's ruling, it would probably need to be put to the UK Parliament as well, in the sense that any of these specific terms, which would involve transitional arrangements and perhaps new arrangements with EU countries, the trading relationship and the transitioning out of existing treaties and so on would affect the, you know, laws in the UK. Presumably there are quite a range of laws that implement in EU law some of the in UK law some of these specifics. So, but I think the important point here may be that the first set of negotiations has to be between the UK and the EU, and whatever terms are arrived at, or whether it's an impasse, but then and how the UK Parliament responds to that would then determine the strategy for external negotiations. That is to say, trade negotiations with non-EU partners. So this seems to me to be all in the fairly distant future, and therefore I would even add more years perhaps to the kind of timetable that Jennifer discussed. And in general, I agree with her analysis. It's obviously seems very simple if you say that the EU currently has a treaty with Korea. Why then would there not be an identical a treaty between the UK and Korea? It's very efficient. But as some of you may have noticed with respect to the negotiation of CETA or CETA, the atmosphere right now in many countries is not that favorable to negotiation of new trade agreements. And of course, it depends on the individual country. In some cases, you may have very little opposition, but in other cases, I would not be surprised if groups that are generally opposed to or want to revisit free trade arrangements would use this as an opportunity to make it very difficult to enter into new agreements, not necessarily because of their hostility to Brexit or the UK, but simply using it as an opportunity to roll back these features of globalization. So I very much doubt, and this goes to the increasing submission of trade agreements to parliamentary approval and even to forms of referenda and plebiscite. So in theory, it seems like a very almost surgical solution to say, okay, we'll have duplicate agreements and just accept the same format. But politics is, I think, likely to make that scenario very difficult. Indeed, there are many groups in the UK itself who would like to roll back certain aspects of globalization that are entrenched in some of these agreements. A word about the WTO. So a number of views exist about how the UK could transition to a different situation in the WTO in light of Brexit, and has been pointed out by Professor Lauren Bartels, among others. The fact is that the UK does have separate membership in the WTO. It's an original GATT member, and through a peculiarity of the transition between the GATT and the WTO, even though the EU is a member of the WTO, the UK as an original GATT member retains its own separate WTO membership. So the starting position would be, in some sense, that in its relations with non-EU countries, the UK could be governed by WTO law in the sense that it's a full member of the WTO, autonomous from its membership in the EU. Now, some people have raised issues about schedules, and there are issues also about how to deal with tariff quotas. In other words, where you have some kind of specific, and this is an issue in agriculture, some kind of specific aggregate amount of protection that's permitted to the EU as a member, do you prorate that or how do you deal with that situation? I think that's probably fairly manageable using standard principles of trying to, avoid as much as possible discrimination or deviations from MFN. And so on. There might be some, difficult negotiations, but I think they would be of a fairly technical nature. The problem, it seems to me, is that because the WTO was created at a time at which the UK was a member of the European Union, and obviously there's a customs union. There are no applicable schedules between the UK and other EU countries. And so with respect to other EU countries, I think they have a quite valid argument that they never consented to any schedule of MFN-based concessions as between themselves and the UK. Right. And so all bets are off, arguably, with respect to the legal basis for trade relations between the UK and the remaining EU member countries. With respect to third countries, they did accept the schedules as a basis for governing their trade relations with the UK, even though the schedules were negotiated and consented to, on the basis of the EU being a member of the WTO and the UK in turn being a member of the EU. And I suppose some WTO member can come along and say that's inequitable because we only would have agreed to this kind of schedule if we were dealing with the entire WTO membership. But I think that's an unlikely argument. So maybe I'll stop there. That's probably enough complexity for 10 minutes or so. And I'd be happy to take any questions.
Rob, this is Jennifer Hillman. I wondered if I could ask one quick question, because like I said, I was sort of openly debating the issue of whether or not you can say that with respect to those mixed competence agreements where they read that the parties to the agreement is the European Union or its member states, or the EU and its member states, which is what most of the free trade agreements do. You've just made the point that the reason why we say the UK is a member of the WTO is because it was already a member of the GATT in 1947. That would not be true for all of these EU FTA agreements. So my question is the fact that there is a different basis on which which way does it cut? In other words, does that tell me that the UK is a member of the WTO because it was a member of the GATT 1947, and because there's no equivalent of the GATT 1947 for all of these FTA agreements, that the UK is not a party on its own to the FTA agreements?
I think it depends, Jennifer, on the precise language of each individual agreement. If it refers to the EU and its member states, then a literal reading of the treaty would mean that the UK would only be a party as long as it is among the member states. Right? So it says UK plus, sorry, it says EU plus member states. How would a treaty continue then to apply to the UK if it's no longer a member state?
The member state at the time of signing.
Right, exactly. So doesn't it have to be a member state at the time at which it continued to be a member state, for the obligation to continue. It doesn't say it applies to the EU and member states and former member states of the EU, right?
But Rob, the reason I'm raising this is because what the actual language says is that the agreement is between the European Union or its member states, and then it lists them all, including the United Kingdom, and then it goes on to say, or the European Union and its member states. So it has it both.
It's a mixed competence treaty.
Because it's a mixed competence treaty, they have this or and language. So it's an agreement between Canada, say, and the European Union or its member states, or the European Union and its member states. That's what it says. So my question to you is, does that mean that the UK is a party on its own to the Canada agreement?
Yes, as long as it continues to be a member state, if the operative language is member state.
Okay, do others disagree with that, that's critical that you remain a member state?
I think probably yes. I think once they're no longer a member state, they're no longer a party. Yeah.
Because, but I see the argument otherwise.
Wait, but when you think about the second part, or its member states, it's because, as you say, it's mixed competences. Right. But mixed competences is about free movement of labor, free right. movement of services, all the four freedoms.
Right.
It's mixed competences. So how can you imagine that a partner to the European Union doesn't have in mind
right.
that trading is on this basis? Yeah. So when a state goes out, you say it's intention, but it's even more
I
than
think
that.
The prevailing it's just view, completely the, included. The mainstream view, I think, is that the UK will not remain a member of any EU FTA when it leaves the European Union.
Yeah, I don't yes. disagree with that. I'm just saying it's an interesting.
Right.
And it then is going to present all of these issues. I mean, I think you raise a really interesting question about whether what it says about the relationship between the UK and the EU, that there are all these free trade agreements. But,
Simon, do you want to?
Yes, sure. I'll start. First thing I'm going to talk about, I'll raise another debate. This is something I think Rob and Jennifer have both talked about a bit. I'm going to comment on when the UK can start free trade agreement talks with other countries. I think I'm in the minority here, but I don't think I'm alone because I know I've talked to other people who agree with me. But I think the UK can start negotiating, but maybe not sign, but can start negotiating free trade agreements with other countries as soon as Article 50 is triggered. Now, this may be too simplistic, but I'm basing this on Article 3, Paragraph 1, Subparagraph E of the Treaty of the Functioning of the European Union, which says, I don't have an exact quote, but something like this, the EU has exclusive competence over the common commercial policy. So I'm putting a lot of emphasis on the word common here. It seems to me that when Article 50 is triggered, the UK has chosen not to participate in the common commercial policy, and it's now setting up its own commercial policy. So yes, certainly, when the EU is talking to Canada about the CETA, the UK can't go off on the side and talk to Canada and set special terms. In that context, when it's the common commercial policy, the UK can't do any negotiating, it's all up to the EU. But if the UK has formally started the process of leaving the EU and wants to go talk to Canada about a trade agreement with Canada, I think they can do it. To me, that seems textually pretty clear. On the other hand, I have no idea what the EU courts would do with this, how they think about these issues. I haven't read enough European court opinions to know what they think of, how they approach texts and context and object and purposes, all of that. I'm sure the European Commission won't like this. They might challenge it, but it seems to me, at least textually, the UK can start negotiating right now. Politically, this might be a problem for the UK-EU trade talks. That would aggravate the EU, so maybe the UK doesn't want to do too much for political reasons, but legally, I think they can do it. And I know there's some disagreement out there, so we can argue about that in a little while. On to the other things I'm going to talk about. So, with regard to UK free trade agreement talks with other countries, there's two questions I want to address. First, what should the UK negotiate about? And second, with whom should they negotiate? We've talked a little bit about this. I'll just sort of elaborate on some of the points. And I'm answering this with a particular goal in mind, which is free trade done quickly. So first, what should the UK negotiate about? Most modern trade agreements, so this is bilateral free trade agreements by the US, EU, other countries. This includes mega regionals like the CETA, TPP, TTIP. Most of these modern trade deals cover trade in goods, trade in services, government procurement, And then intellectual property, investment protection, labor, environment, sustainable development, competition policy, anti-corruption, regulatory cooperation, regulatory practices, state-owned enterprises, free flow of information. The list of the contents of these agreements just keep growing. Now, maybe that's fine, and maybe everything belongs in there. Maybe that is the gold standard of trade agreements, as people keep referring to it. On the other hand, maybe it's just loaded up with lobbyist demands resulting in bad policy. It depends on your perspective. But regardless of whether you think all this stuff belongs in trade agreements, one thing I think is pretty certain, and that is you can't get a quick deal with all of this in here. Jennifer talked earlier about the CETA and how it's taken 7 years, and we're only at the provisional application stage. It's not really done yet. If you want a deal that's done quickly, I don't think you can include all these things in here. I couldn't give you an exact comparison of how long it would take to do a particular kind of deal, but you're definitely talking at 5 to 7 years or more to cover all of these things, whereas I think you could do a simpler deal in 1 to 2 years. If you include things like investor-state dispute settlement or the new European investment court system, if you include geographical indications and biologics and encryption policies, it's all going to take time and raise controversy. But I think you can do it more simply by focusing on the following. First, the basics of trade that has been with us since the beginning, tariffs and quotas. I said this earlier, I'll say it again, I think it's less realistic this time. The simplest way to do it would be for both parties to come to the table and say tariffs and quotas should be zero. No haggling on sensitive items, no phase outs. But I know that's not realistic, but sort of set that as a goal. And I think the simpler, the more you approach it that way, the simpler it'll be. Services is going to be more complicated, and I know it's very important to the UK, so can't just ignore it. I mean, you have to be honest about it. If you're going to negotiate for passporting, it's gonna take you a little while. But what I suggest there is to pick a few service sectors that are of particular importance, like financial services. Use a positive list and figure out how to open up services markets for those particular services that you care about. Exclude things like the National Health Service. Get that off the table right now. If you put that in there, it's going to take a long time. It's going to be controversial. So choose carefully. Pick the most important ones, the least controversial ones. And then similarly for government procurement, again, pick a few areas of government procurement where you think it would be easiest to liberalize. So those basic three things should be part of any UK free trade agreements. On the other hand, I mentioned investment, intellectual property, labor, environment. We can skip those. There are issues like technical barriers to trade, sanitary and phytosanitary measures. In my view, the WTO does a lot with these. I don't know that you need to include special chapters on that in a free trade agreement. And even more boldly, I would say you could think about farming out dispute settlement to the WTO. You don't actually need a dispute settlement chapter, a specialized dispute settlement chapter in an FTA. You've got the WTO. Work out some way to go to the WTO for these things. Finally, another area that I'd want to put in there, which I recognize is controversial, but I think it's very beneficial, is mutual recognition for goods trade. I think the best thing to do is just sort of set up a process for it in a trade agreement and work out the details sector by sector later. I mean, if you're going to bring in all the regulatory issues from the beginning, you're probably going to get bogged down like we've seen with the TTIP. But I think you can at least set a framework for it and sort of set up a process for going forward with it. One controversial area that I want to add in, and I'm sure everyone will object to, but this is just sort of a personal goal of mine, is anti-dumping. I don't think you need anti-dumping laws in general, and if anyone can agree, and it's happened before, Australia and New Zealand have done it, it is theoretically possible. If anyone could agree in an FTA not to take anti-dumping measures as between each other, I think it would be wonderful. I recognize that's asking a lot. So in my view, this is what the UK should propose. And the question of will they get it, it depends on who their partner is. So let me talk quickly about who the UK should negotiate with. And Jennifer talked about some of these issues. So what criteria should we use to decide who the UK should negotiate a trade agreement with? She mentioned where the trade barriers are biggest. Also sort of the size of the economy, the size of the trading relationship the UK has with the countries. I would also look at where the negotiations would be smoothest. Is it a country you get along with? Do they have similar goals? Do they want a trade agreement? And then also, we should try to minimize any external controversy. When you start You know, when there are a bunch of protesters outside the meetings, that tends to slow things down. So I looked up, you know, who are the UK's top non-European trading partners, and you get the US, China, Canada, India, Russia, Japan, Australia, South Africa, Korea, United Arab Emirates, and Singapore. So my suggestions for, based on those criteria, for the first round of negotiations, I would say, and I'll tell you why in a second, Australia, New Zealand, US, Canada, Japan, and Korea. I don't mean to exclude the others or ignore them. I just think it might be they might come sort of in the second group. So China, India, Brazil, Mexico, Vietnam, these are all big countries. These are important trading partners. I worry, though, that when you talk about competition with low-wage countries, that it just leads to too much controversy. So I just wouldn't want to start with one where the protests and the concerns are going to be the biggest. So I would start with these others. And I would really go first with Australia and New Zealand. Even though they are smaller in terms of probably the amount of trade, I think they're the most liberal, most open to trade. I think it would establish a good model and set a good precedent to work with those two countries first. The US and Canada are both a little bit complicated. So as we know, Canada and the EU have their almost provisionally applied trade agreement already. So that leads to complications of, well, can the UK adopt the CETA as its own? Does it have to start fresh? I don't know the answer to that. With trade agreement with the US, again, you have the TTIP out there, the US and the EU negotiating on their own. That one, I feel like it hasn't made as much progress. It may be fair to say it's stalled and is not going anywhere. So there, I think the UK should just negotiate directly with the US. And then I also threw in Japan and Korea. I see a lot of positives there. Korea, as we know, also the EU has an FTA with already. So you have this question of, can we just adopt what's already there? And I think that might work. Japan, I picked Japan in part because they used to be a big skeptic of anti-dumping, as I am. So there's this possibility that the UK and Japan would negotiate an FTA that I'm sure would exclude many sensitive agricultural sectors, which would bother me, but at the least, there's some chance of finding somebody who's willing to go along with excluding anti-dumping. So I see lots of panicking in the UK that the leadership is inept and there are no trade negotiators and none of this would ever get done. To me, this actually sounds like a lot of fun. So I'm really looking forward to this going forward, just so we can see how it works and we can try it out. And I'm happy to offer them lots of free, unsolicited advice about what they should do.
So I have a couple of questions about your presentation. So am I understanding you correct to say that you think that they should start with a shallow FTA and then subsequently negotiate a deep FTA? Or do you mean that there should be an interim FTA and then a permanent FTA at a later stage?
I think it should be permanent right away, and I'm keeping it, reluctant to use the word shallow, but I guess it's shallow. I'm focusing on specific issues that I consider to be the core of trade liberalization, and I'm saying when you get into these other issues, I'm not even sure they're liberalization. I mean, you can have an international agreement on intellectual property, but I don't know if we can even call that liberalization. I've tried to figure out intellectual property over the past few years. And, is it liberalization to have a copyright term of life of the author plus 70 years? I'm not sure that it is. So I'm saying there are a bunch of issues where I'm not sure if there are benefits, and I see lots of controversy. So I think we should just exclude them. At the same time, I think we should eventually be able to go deeper on regulatory issues, but I think we have to go really slowly. I think that's where a lot of sensitivity lies. To that extent, I would say yes, start with a certain set of issues and then go forward later with the more sensitive regulatory cooperation issues. So yes, I think I am saying that, although I'm saying there are some that I would just exclude entirely because they're too controversial and I don't see the benefits.
So I just have one comment. So I think when we started this process in 1947 with the WTO, the world was a little simpler, and part of the reason why we needed to restructure the whole agreement in 95 was because of all the complexities of different types of government innovations. So if you just think about a little bit your suggestion, so on the one hand, it was like, well, let's start in terms of a trade agreement with something that we could say is shallow, like let's just work on external barriers to trade. So zero tariffs, free no quotas. Mm-hmm. So then you start to think of, and then you also throw out, well, let's have no anti-dumping. So I took that to be broader, to be contingent policy. Okay, so safeguards, anti-dumping, countervailing duties may not be what you meant, but let me just throw out the problem that arises there. Well, so now I'm an innovative government and I just signed an agreement with you and I decide, actually, you know what I want to do? I want to establish state-owned enterprises. I want to go back to 1970, and this is going to be what I think is the way forward for policy in my country. And now I'm going to heavily subsidize domestic industries. And you just signed a free trade agreement with me, and you've also tied your hands to prevent any action to counteract that. So, you know, I like the idea of trying to think of, like, what's the most we can do? Can Britain go forward and just say, you know, we want to have free trade, we're going to go with zero tariffs, but part of the reason why all of these agreements have become more complex is partly a reaction to the innovations in policy that have happened in the last 50 years, and that we've waxed and waned between more activist industrial policy and subsidies. So there was a time in the 80s and 90s when there were a lot of countervailing duties around the world that went out of vogue, especially in, like, the high-income West. Basically, you know, with the exception of the recent GM bailout, there wasn't a lot of activist industrial policy that was impacting trade flows, and so we didn't see so many countervailing duty cases. At the same time, we see a lot of government intervention cropping up in China in particular. And so I'm worried, you know, so one of the things is part of the reason why these agreements are so complex is they need to balance off rigid commitments to something like free trade with some flexibility to deal with them. And I think, you know, all of these additional complicated regulatory barriers, it's hard to see how, you know, tying your hands too much can be a problem. And it's also hard to think about, well, there is a different sensibility now, I think, realistically, than there was in 1950 about things like the environment, global warming, energy use, labor law, and concern for, you know, workers. And I think it's going to be hard to go forward with agreements that don't include those.
Well, so let me answer that. I'm relying to some extent on the existence of the WTO. WTO is out there.
Okay.
So, you know, if you have concerns about subsidies, I mean, we've got rules on subsidies. Now, obviously, they're not perfect, and we can talk about how, you know, mm-hmm. which subsidies are falling through the cracks. I did focus on anti-dumping because, yes, I mean, I guess ideally I'd get rid of all the trade remedies, but anti-dumping, I feel like, is the one I can attack most effectively. And so I would leave countervailing duties there. So those still exist. The subsidies remedies still exist. Standard enterprises, it's not clear to me at this point what exactly the problem is. I mean, people talk about subsidies to state-owned enterprises. Well, if it's subsidies, well, aren't those already covered by the subsidies rules? But maybe it's not subsidies. Maybe it's just, you know, the behavior of these state-owned enterprises. So I can imagine that there are some rules that we need on state-owned enterprises. And in the TPP, we have some, although as I understand it, we've carved out all the actual state-owned enterprises from the rules, so it's not actually going to apply to anybody. But yes, maybe that's a good first step. So I don't want to rule out, you know, ever doing anything about state-owned enterprises. I don't know if an individual FTA is the place for it, and maybe not one between, say, the UK and Australia, because it's not really an issue there. So that's one where I can accept something there, but I'd want to hear more about what the problem is we're dealing with.
Well, I think this is the problem with trade agreement design in general, is we started out with a simple agreement to deal with a simple problem of just we want to engage in more international commerce. But then there are different ways you realize, oh, actually, maybe I'm engaging in more than I want to, or not in the way I want to. And that's where you start to see these changes. So then we have changes domestically of governments trying to do things to better their own interests. And this is where, like, that's where we get into things like first subsidies. Well, now then we had a bunch of rules regulating subsidies. So then we still have subsidies, but they have a different name and they come in a slightly different form. And we've explicitly banned some things under the WTO. So then we have to make things more and more transparent. And so I think partly the agreements are always catching up with the new innovations in economic policy making that are now more and more distorting international trade. And so once we get rid of the easy stuff, you start to see this complexity. So that's just where I like the idea of, can't we just go ahead and try to do something clear and transparent? But I can also see something's got to happen. Either we explicitly say every complicated problem we're just going to mimic the WTO, because maybe we do want to just adopt WTO subsidy policy because it's going to be too complicated to do anything else. And the only thing that this agreement will deliver will be lower tariffs than you have at the WTO. Right, for the two parties to the agreement.
I think lower tariffs, but also mutual recognition for goods and basically mutual recognition for services as well. I mean, I think that's where we can go further. And I guess I'm pushing for as much as I can, but knowing that I won't get it all. And so, you know, just as I think the easy example, I mean, we all know how controversial investor protection is. I just don't think you need it in many of these agreements. And if you do, it's going to take years and it's going to be controversial. So I was pushing for all of it, hoping that I'd actually get some of it. And I understand if in order for the U.S. to have a trade agreement, they need a labor and environmental chapter in there. I can understand that. I can accept that. I'm just sort of pointing out, you know, the ones that I think are likely to get in the way, and maybe we can put aside. And also, if you're talking about the U.K., I mean, they're in kind of a special situation of, well, suddenly we've thrown into this new world where we're supposed to be negotiating FTAs. We would like to get some done fairly quickly. And if you want to avoid the 7-year CETA, you know, term, well, maybe you need to do something different. Because if you go down that road, it's probably going to take you 7 years.
Okay, let me finish up with the last discussion for session two. And I'm going to start from the premise that Jennifer raised, which was that the existing FTAs that the European has with other, European Union has with other countries are not going to continue for the benefit of the United Kingdom. So that, I think, is the prevailing view, and that, I think, therefore, is what the UK has to think about in terms of its negotiating status post-Brexit. So my sort of starting premise is that it is going to be difficult to imagine that the UK will enjoy the current trading status that it has currently anytime in the near future. This is a self-inflicted wound for the United Kingdom, and it's going to take years, if not decades, for the UK just to get back to the current status in terms of trade. So the UK's relationship with almost every major trading partner is affected by Brexit. The vast majority of its top trading partners are either EU members or countries that have preferential trade agreements with the European Union. So we've already talked about, you know, all the key trading partners that the United Kingdom has with the European Union. But in addition to that, Switzerland, Norway, Canada, Turkey, South Africa, Korea, they're all examples of UK's top 25 trading countries that have PTAs with the European Union. So China and the United States are the only great notable exceptions in which they wouldn't need to negotiate a separate free trade agreement to get the current status quo that they have. And this is not to mention over a dozen FTAs that the European Union is currently negotiating with countries such as India, Japan, Singapore, and the United States with the TTIP. So it's going to be very, very difficult essentially for the UK just to get where it is right now if it withdraws from the European Union. So as has already been discussed, the UK is of course going to try to replicate many of these FTAs and also create new ones with countries such as Australia, New Zealand, and the United States. I perfectly expect that New Zealand and Australia will be amenable to that. The United States is obviously more complicated because trade is unusually unpopular right now in the United States. And so I have difficulty imagining that the United States is going to bend over backwards just to help out the United Kingdom when it's already struggling with its own sort of internal politics regarding free trade agreements. If the UK withdraws from the European Union, it will take decades then to bring the UK back to its current trading position. By way of background, to sort of underscore the significance of the European Union as a trading partner, the EU is the most important and most active force in the world of FTAs. It has over 34 agreements, not to mention the other ones that you talked about, Jennifer, far more than any other country. The United States, by contrast, has 14 such agreements. If you look at Jus Paulens and Wolfgang Alschner's network analysis, of the different nodes and connections of different countries based on free trade agreements. The EU is the central node, right? There is no other country that is more central to the world of FTAs than the European Union. In their words, it's the most central node and the pivoting point in the PTA network. So by withdrawing from the European Union, the UK will be abandoning the most important and far-reaching FTA network in the world. In terms of FTAs, it will take years for the UK to try and replicate what it currently has as an EU member. Apart from its negotiating with the EU, it must convince other countries, and this is I think a key point that I think is underappreciated, it must convince other countries that it deserves the same time and attention to negotiate as those countries are giving to the European Union. Norway, for example, tried to negotiate a TTIP with the United States, and the United States said, we'll deal with you after we have a deal with the European Union. So one wonders why the UK should jump the queue for all of these other agreements that are currently under negotiation with the European Union and with TPP and the United States and others. So it's possible that the UK could get sort of accelerated status given its importance, but I think it's difficult. So I don't mean to suggest that the United Kingdom will not be able to enter into FTAs. I do think that they will. I just think it will take an extraordinarily long amount of time. If you look at Norway and Switzerland as models, Iceland, they're all examples of 25 FTAs. So relatively large number of FTAs that have been negotiated, despite the fact that they're not a member of the European Union. Chile has 22 FTAs. Singapore has 19 FTAs. So I do think it's possible, very possible, that the United Kingdom could eventually get to the point where it has a significant number of FTAs and it sort of replicates where it currently is. Obviously, the United Kingdom is the fifth largest economy in the world, and it's quite plausible then that after years of negotiations, it will generate those FTAs. I think that's plausible. Norway is a good case study. In 1972, voters rejected EC membership in a referendum, so they never became a member of the European Community, subsequently European Union, but then it went on to develop a network of 26 FTAs. So I certainly think that that is the kind of thing that the UK will try to do. But by doing so, all they're doing is trying to catch up to the current status that they currently enjoy. It will be exceedingly difficult for the UK to create an FTA network as significant and far-reaching as the current EU FTA network. And of course, as I mentioned, the EU FTA network is a moving target as it continues to expand to other key markets, countries like Japan, India, and the United States. So as they're constantly trying to catch up to where they were as a member of the European Union, the EU is going to go further and deeper with other countries as well, and then the UK is going to try to be catching up to those countries as well. So that's sort of my overall baseline premise, which was the United Kingdom is going to have an incredibly difficult time getting this sort of FTA network that it currently has as a member of the European Union. So the last thing I wanted to talk about, which is sort of a slightly different issue, we've talked about sort of the FTA network as a sense of opportunities that the United Kingdom should try to exploit. But I also want to suggest that it's possible to think about the relationship that the United Kingdom has with the European Union and that the United Kingdom has with other FTA countries as not simply an opportunity that they hope to exploit, but actually as an obligation that they're required to exploit, right? So the UK, when they talk of Brexit, should focus not just on the idea that they have opportunities to try to maintain their own regulatory sovereignty, they actually should also think about the idea that there are obligations to foreign investors to maintain a stable regulatory framework. So the analogy I think that is useful, and I know that in the investment arbitration world has been talked about a lot, is the Argentina investment situation. So as everyone in the investment arbitration world knows, in 2002, Argentina took measures to address its economic crisis that led to a severe devaluation of its peso. As a result of Argentina's actions, which essentially was one or two statutes that dramatically changed the economic status of foreign investors, over 40 claims were brought against Argentina, the greatest wave of investment arbitration claims in history. The crux of those claims was that the government had violated the bilateral investment treaty obligations by denying foreign investors fair and equitable treatment. Specifically, cases suggest that investors have, quote, legitimate expectations as a key component of fair and equitable treatment. Most obviously, contractual commitments give rise to legitimate expectations, so any contract that the United Kingdom has entered into with foreign investors gives rise to contractual commitments and legitimate expectations. But also, to the extent that the United Kingdom has made unilateral assertions or promises, the case law suggests that even those unilateral promises about what kind of deal they're going to get potentially give rise to claims for foreign investment violations. So those are sort of contractual claims and unilateral promises that have been made. There's another third issue that is incredibly significant and potentially harmful to the United Kingdom, and that is that there is this case law that suggests that a fundamental change to the regulatory environment gives rise to a claim under investment agreements. In other words, legitimate expectations can be created through the general regulatory framework that has been established through specific transactions or through government assurances to the investor. The case law also suggests that investors are more likely to expect regulatory stability in developed countries rather than developing countries. So essentially, the arbitrators are willing to give a pass to countries like Pakistan or Argentina to a greater extent than they would give a pass to a developed country like the United Kingdom. There's a greater expectation of regulatory stability in a country like the United Kingdom than there is in a country like Argentina or Pakistan. And as a result of that, foreign investors have a greater chance of succeeding at a claim of violations of bilateral investment treaties. So if, think about it this way as a sort of matter of reciprocity, if British investors and other investors were able to succeed against Argentina for its relatively modest change to the Argentine regulatory environment through the depesoization of its agreements, will foreign investors likewise be able to bring a claim against the United Kingdom for its decision to fundamentally alter its regulatory environment? In over 100 separate bits, the United Kingdom has made commitments similar to the following. Investments of nationals or companies of either contracting party shall at all times be accorded fair and equitable treatment and shall enjoy full protection and security in the territory of other contracting parties. Each contracting party shall ensure that the management, maintenance, use, enjoyment, or disposal of investments in its territory of nationals or companies of the other contracting party is not in any way impaired by unreasonable or discriminatory measures. So the key question for the United Kingdom with respect to complying with its obligations to foreign investors that are currently here in the United Kingdom under over 100 separate bilateral investment treaties is whether a change in the regulatory framework by withdrawing from the European Union and the European FTA network is so severe and radical that a tribunal would find a violation of fair and equitable treatment by reference to an investor's frustration of its legitimate expectations. So, every investor that comes in here makes assumptions about what they're getting when they come to the United Kingdom, and those assumptions are now being undermined, arguably, right? Not the referendum itself, but if there was a future withdrawal from the European Union, either the Article 50 triggering or the ultimate withdrawal, then I think there's an argument to be made that there may be significant foreign investment claims. So just two examples, the automotive industry and then the banking industry. So 57% of UK car exports are to the European Union. Within the European Union, the duties are, of course, zero. Outside the European Union and under the WTO rules, the tariffs on cars are 10%. So the EU charges 10% for cars coming outside the Euro, but 0% for cars coming from within the European. Major plants in the United Kingdom include brands owned by Germany, Japan, Malaysia, India, and China. So the question is, in the context of zero tariffs going to 10% tariffs for UK automobile plants exporting to the European Union, which constitute a majority of all UK exports of cars, is it credible to say that automakers who built plants in the United Kingdom with the legitimate expectation of a stable regulatory environment in which they could export their cars to the EU duty-free and to EU's FTA network duty-free are able to bring a claim of a denial of their legitimate expectations? The British auto industry says that they are, the quote that they're giving in the press, that they are at risk of dying a death by a thousand cuts, with tariffs creating a critical challenge in an industry with wafer-thin margins. So specific assurances, such as reported by promises by the United Kingdom to Nissan in Sutherland, as well as the potential just complete change in the regulatory environment might give claims for the auto industry for a BIT violation. Not all of those countries that I mentioned have BITs with the United States, but some of them, like Malaysia, do. Take the banking industry, which we've already talked about. Banks have established themselves in the United Kingdom in part to freely conduct business throughout Europe. Almost 5,500 UK firms rely on corporate passports to conduct business across the European Union. According to one British government official, Andrew Tyrie, losing full access to the European single market in financial services could put the UK banking industry at significant risk. So if the UK cannot address the fundamental change to the banking regulatory environment by the loss of passporting or similar internal market rights, foreign investors will argue, potentially, that they established themselves in the United Kingdom with the quite reasonable and legitimate expectation that they could access the European market. So that's the sort of overarching premise that I think is being considered right now in the foreign investment world. So I'm not meaning to suggest whatsoever that governments cannot change their laws, right? The case law is crystal clear that governments have the freedom to change their laws to comply with the wills of the people and the needs for regulatory improvement. So no tribunal would ever say that bilateral investment treaties freeze the laws of every country. But what they do say is that there's a difference between changing the laws and fundamentally changing a country's regulatory environment. So I don't mean to make too much of this. It's yet to be determined whether this has any traction whatsoever. But at least I think it's safe to say that when the United Kingdom is negotiating with the European Union and when it's negotiating with other countries with respect to FTAs, that they have to consider the possibility that if the regulatory framework changes too much, that they open themselves up to potential liability from existing foreign investors. So basically that would be my sort of additional question for foreign international investment arbitration and whether it might have an impact on the way the UK negotiates its deals. Any thoughts on that?
Well, one sort of an interesting I at least thought was, you know, fairly early on after the referendum and the statements that Brexit means Brexit and, you know, all of that, Japan sent a message to the United Kingdom and to the European Union, which for those of us that have watched messages coming out of Japan over many years, this one was a shocker because it was so blunt and in many ways fairly undiplomatic. And just to give you a flavor of it, it says that, you know, we've been informed of a variety of requests by Japanese businesses, including, and it basically is saying these four things, in essence saying, if you do not do this, UK and the EU, either A, our Japanese investors are pulling out, or B, they are going to consider the kind of claims that you're describing. I mean, they're not actually threatening we're going to file all these investment arbitrations, but they're hinting at that. Either we're going to pull our investments out, or we're going to make claims. So what they say they have to have is maintenance of trade in goods with no burdens of customs duties and procedures. So you got to keep duty free. Yeah. Secondly, unfettered investment. All right. Third, maintenance of an environment in which services and financial transactions across Europe can be provided and carried out smoothly. Fourth, access to workforces with necessary skills. And fifth, harmonized regulations and standards between the UK and the EU. So Japan is already putting everybody on notice that if we don't get these things, we may pull all our investments out, or option B would be to bring investor state claims to say you've effectively taken my property, you've effectively taken my investment because you've made it impossible for me to continue to operate my business. It's the effect of a taking and you have to pay me compensation.
Or if not a taking, at least a violation of fair and equitable treatment,
right,
which
exactly.
is sort of a different category.
Yeah, yeah. I mean, it could right. fall either way.
Right. Right. But what kind of compensation would that be that they could
well,
get
it's a
as
taking,
investors?
I mean, I think you're right. If it's a, well, you go ahead. I mean,
if it's a taking, it's the fair market value of the investment, which would be massive, right? But if it's a fair and equitable treatment, it essentially would be the damages that are suffered as a result of the change in the regulatory environment. So in the Argentina cases, it was a currency difference between the dollarization versus pesoization of those investments. So ended up being billions of dollars.
I think it would be interesting to see where foreign investment into the UK comes from and what bits are out there. Because I assume there's no UK-Japan bit. I could
there's
be
not a UK-Japan bit, right. but there are. I mapped the bits with okay. the FTAs,
yeah.
and there's a lot of overlap. But okay. you're absolutely right. I don't know if Japan would be able to do it under a bit. They'd have to
right.
do it under some sort of contractual assurances or
right.
stabilization clauses in a contract or something like that.
Yeah.
Right.
Because, yeah, I mean,
I think Japan would be hard to bring any
right.
sort of specific foreign investment claim.
Isn't there some Indian company that owns some steel making there? I can imagine.
Yeah,
there's a UK
India also bit. Owns Jaguar and Land Rover.
Ah, right.
So.
Okay.
Yeah.
So here's a question, because this relates to something I was thinking about. What exactly could Theresa May have said to the Nissan ownership?
Right.
And so, if they brought it, if Nissan wanted to say, well, we've lost access to the European market, there's a 10% tariff, we need fair and equitable treatment, so we need compensation from you for the flow value. Like, we want to keep exporting cars, but we want you to continually compensate us. That's also, in WTO language, that's a financial benefit, which is countervailable in Europe, right? I mean, so in some sense,
the European Union apparently has already given notice to the United Kingdom that if you're making promises like that, that that's a state aid that we're going to
countervail. So I mean, like, this could, you know, there's also this idea that an investment claim in and of itself, if it were found and it were compensated, would be violating the obligations under the WTO not to subsidize.
You mean if there were specific assurances about what we're, how we're going to negotiate, or
you
what we're going to give
you?
You
pay the claim.
Well, so I'm saying, like, say I'm Nissan and I say, I didn't get fair and equitable treatment. I'm going to go to investment arbitration and demand compensation. So maybe the government's not willingly providing this, but they're going to be ordered to provide me with compensation.
And that could be a subsidy.
Then I export to Europe. That's a subsidy. Mm. Yeah. That subsidy is countervailable under the WTO. So, I mean, it's interesting that the two areas of law are clashing here. I mean, or not clashing, I guess they could just both keep going through, but we're getting to a situation where the trade environment is getting worse and worse because we've got, on the one hand, this violation to the investors' rights, and then on the other hand, it could perpetrate, you know, compensating that could create even more problems under the WTO.
It's a similar case in the EU, right? I think there was some investment claim against like an Eastern European country, and when they paid it, or were talking about paying it, then the European Commission was going to investigate a state aid.
Okay, I didn't realize that. So
I don't know the resolution of where that stands now, but yes, that.
Okay.
And it was really one of these very difficult ones where, you know, in essence, the investment system is telling them you must pay, and then the European Union is saying, and if you pay, it's a subsidy.
It's state.
I mean, I do think that the government is acutely aware of the sort of business response to a hard Brexit. So, and I think all I'm trying to suggest is the business response to a hard Brexit is multifaceted and deeply complicated. And it's not just about, we want you to do a good deal for us going forward. It's also, if you don't do it, then you are violating your promises to us. So that's another way to think about it.
I think what you've raised is fascinating. I mean, I think this adds, for what it's worth, it could add a huge amount of negative in terms of just dollar value of negative. I think harder would be all the ones you're talking about the banking, et cetera, because it's harder to say that you had a legitimate expectation in certain things. I think on the tariff side, it's part of me says, just think about that, because anytime you're then raising tariffs, because I do think there's a real legitimate expectation that tariffs are not going to go up.
Right.
I mean, that they're bound, you're required to bind them. So they've been bound within the WTO since 1995. So you've got 20 plus years of having the tariff at 10% and zero within the European Union. I think that one's really problematic. And if you now start adding, it's not just cars, I mean, add all the ones up. And, you know, the amount of trade, it's very huge in terms of what the dollar value would be. And I hadn't even thought about that. But I think in terms of the potential implications for the UK, it's quite substantial.
Any other comments?
And would add to the litany of reasons why people don't like ISDS, investor state dispute
settlement. Yes, it would.
I mean,
yeah, it would. Exactly.
I think that would really, really doom ISDS, but not that it's not already semi-doomed, but... Yeah.
All right, let's take a break, and we'll come back for session 3 at 6 o'clock.